Hi there, this is Rintu Basu. I'm the author of this book here, the Persuasion Skills Black Book, and all of that is about hypnotic language patterns and how you can use them in everyday life for influence persuasion, both on other people and yourself. This particular video is going to be all about NLP courses, and more specifically, the course that I run. Now, the reason that I wanted to put this together is basically because I'm asked a couple of questions all the time around all of this. Through the rest of this video, what we're actually going to look at is an answer to these two particular questions all in one, because it's what I get asked a lot. Why bother going on an NLP practitioner course? And more specifically, why bother going on my one? So that's what we're going to answer. But to do that, I actually want to give you some real concrete, specific kind of information about what practitioner courses are actually about, or more specifically, what my practitioner course is about, and how you can use some of the core ideas even before you've gone on that course. You can read on my website and in articles that I've written and all that sort of stuff, lots about the inside track of what actually a practitioner course is about and all the detailed contents of what I've got on my course. I didn't want to do that for you. You can read that for yourself. What I want to do is chunk the whole thing up a little and talk specifically about the generalities of this course, you know, and the big themes and why and how that is useful. Not every practitioner and not every NLP trainer will necessarily completely agree with me. And at least for me, NLP is about modelling. It's this thing that we're really after. What is modelling? Well, it's actually being able to look at how people do things. And it's being able to look at that and then being able to deconstruct it so that you can actually get all the fine details out of it, all the special bits that make it special, and be able to then take that from the head of that master who's doing all of this stuff, and take that and being able to put it into someone else's head, whether that's yours or whether it's someone else's. You know, you could be a coach or a trainer that's actually developing courses and structures and things to get people to be able to do all sorts of stuff that they want to do, or it could be that you want to just take this stuff and be able to do it for yourself. NLP for me is all about modelling. It's actually all about being able to see and work out what people are doing in their own heads and with their bodies, to be able to deconstruct that and then reconstruct that for someone else to be able to use it. The kind of obvious things that you're going to use it for are, say, things like playing tennis or golf. That's what coaches and modellers and that do an awful lot of, you know, in terms of sports and athletics and things. Maybe you might want to touch type or even be able to learn how to draw the way that I do. With a lot of that sort of modelling, it's just about the physical skill. You know, say for example, I spent a while with a typist because I wanted to improve my typing speed. I didn't really want to go on a touch typing course. All I actually wanted to do was get better at typing. So what I did was sit down with a couple of people that I knew were really, really fast typers. And I, typists, typers, who knows? And I watched them typing. And one of the things that I got from it straight away was that they have a very specific kind of way of holding their hands so that they can reach more of the keyboard and that sort of stuff. And part of that also becomes part of your posture as well. So this one secretary that I watched quite closely with all of this stuff, I noticed that she has a way of particularly sitting where she has her feet tucked under her bottom and she holds her hands in a particular kind of way which gives her a very upright kind of stance, and that's how she types. And as soon as I started doing that, I actually noticed that my typing speed went up, and it's all to do with the physicality of it all. I've subsequently learned how to slouch and still be able to do that, which is great stuff. But for me, the reality of modelling though is being able to mimic all of these physical things and being able to improve your golf or your tennis or your typing or any of those sorts of things is absolutely fabulous. And the reality of this is that this modelling thing here is far, far bigger and far more important than that. Let me ask you a question. If you were to take your favourite hobby or your favourite sport and say, look, we can find ways of getting you to improve at that, most people would be up for it. What I would rather have an idea of is modelling the stuff that actually perhaps I don't enjoy. And what I mean by that is it's easy to get better at stuff when you're good at it. What I really want to know is find the model for things where you succeed despite yourself or despite the circumstances. So let's say, for example, the thing that differentiates a good tennis player from an absolutely great tennis player is how that great tennis player succeeds despite the situation they find themselves in. For example, let's say they wind up being 3 or 4 sets down and they are just about to lose the match. Then perhaps they come back from that and eventually they win the entire game. Now, what I would like to be able to do is to be able to model that mindset. And that's a whole new game in terms of modeling, and it's also one that NLP is all about. I'm not really that bothered about modeling the physicality of what's going on. What I want to know is, say for example, if we're talking about writing, I write lots of articles. What I want to know is, where do all of those great writers get their ideas from? How do they do that? What's the sequence of images and internal representations that they have inside their brain? Look, I've done all the research. This is what brains look like when you cut them open. That's one of the things you could be doing, is modeling the way that I draw. This is pure skill here. Now, I want to know the sequence of internal representations that goes through that person's head to get them motivated to sit down and write when they don't feel like they want to write. I have to do this stuff when perhaps I'm not feeling great, or the world's against me, or I just want to go back to bed. What is it that I run through my head that's going to make me go and do what's necessary to change me from being an average writer to being a great writer? That is what I'd want to model from the truly brilliant and genius people out there. What I want to know is, what are their beliefs? What do they believe about themselves and their world? What kind of attitude do they have towards life in general and to all their specialist skills? Now, NLP does this great thing about being able to look at all of those sorts of things. They look at people that are absolutely genius at stuff, and they go, I wonder what's happening inside their head. How do they see this reflection of themselves? How do they see the rest of the world that's out there? And what is it that's going on that allows them to manifest the kind of genius that they manifest? How do they deal with the adversity? How do they get to be just that one level above where just good people are? This is what I think NLP is really about. So let's delve a little bit deeper into that and look at how these sorts of things happen. Now, I tend to want to think about people as big icebergs. And what I'm going to suggest is that they move in a particular direction, and the easy bit of modelling is seeing how they get to move in that particular direction. You can see the skills they use. You can see the behaviours that they use to move them in that direction. But the reality of what's going on for them is all happening underneath that waterline. And under there's beliefs, there's attitudes, there's mindsets, there's all the things that are important to them that you can't see. And it is this bit here that actually defines which direction they want to go in. So it doesn't matter what consciously they decide. I mean, say for example, they've decided they want to go in that particular direction. But if all of their beliefs don't support that, if their values don't support it, if all of their thoughts about themselves under here doesn't support that direction, they will go where all of this dictates that they will, because that's much bigger and much more powerful. So I think fundamentally this stuff here defines the difference between people that are truly great at anything and those that merely succeed or actually don't even get started in the first place. There's lots of, if I use myself as a personal example, there's lots of skills and lots of things that I kind of want to be able to do, and I don't even start. And I suspect that you may well find the same is true about you in your life, and you probably see this in lots of other people. Let me give you an example. I've met a lot of people that will say to me, I would really, really love to be a musician. Not even a really particularly good musician, I just want to be able to play a bit on a guitar or a piano or anything like that. Now, I have got structure that will actually be able to teach you how to be able to do that in 10 minutes a day. You just have to keep going 10 minutes a day for 30 days and you'll see a massive improvement. Do it for 90 days, you'll see an even more of an improvement. Within 100 days, you'll be at performance standard just playing 10 minutes a day. Now, the reality of all of this is the biggest, bestest, greatest musicians out there do a heck of a lot more than 10 minutes a day. I'm never going to deny that. And if you just do 10 minutes a day, you'll get there. You'll get to a decent performing standard. You know, if you spend a little bit more time every day, you might get there faster. If you're not, say, a natural musician, it might take you a little bit longer. But say, who cares? 10 minutes a day for 100 days. And you'll do it without any problem whatsoever. And I say that to people and they run away screaming, because the reality is, however much they want to be a musician, the cost of doing that, even if it's only 10 minutes a day, is way too much. I do the same with people for hypnotic language patterns. I mean, really, I have got a structure and a pattern and a process that you can learn. I've modelled that through lots and lots of different people, and I've tweaked and played with that model until it's very, very specific, and you can do this easily. And again, this is one of the structures I've learned about accelerated learning. 10 minutes a day is enough to seriously shift people. In fact, 10 minutes a day is actually far, far better than the hundreds of hours that people pour into these things. Basically, for a whole lot of reasons, in that it keeps your motivation up. It looks at, you have to be very, very precise about how you learn if you're only going to spend 10 minutes focused on it. And there's a whole raft of other benefits of using, say, like a 10 minute a day formula, which I've modelled out of people that are great at accelerated learning. Though, is I come across people and they go, yeah, 10 minutes a day, I can put that in. And then I say to them, okay, one part of learning to really properly use language is to go out there and use it with people. And then they run away screaming again. And they do it because the fear of being caught out or looking silly or not being able to do this in front of someone else is greater than actually how they perceive the benefits of being able to do this. And that, if you like, is all of this stuff that's underneath the waterline. It's that stuff that stops them. In fact, I know people that are, or you know, that would be naturals at whatever it is that we're looking to get them to do, absolute naturals at it, and yet they spectacularly fail to get any better because of this stuff underneath. Imagine what happens if you can model people that are good at this stuff. It is context dependent. I suspect that the model that makes you great at certain stuff in terms of this bit here is wildly different from someone else. I have things that make me move as a writer. I've looked at, say, for example, Stephen King, and what makes him move as a writer, what motivates him. There's a story that he says about him and what motivates him to write. He says that when he's having a bad day and he can't think of anything to write, and he'd much rather go off and eat a plate of chips or whatever, something that he does is he sits there in front of his keyboard, looks at a blank screen, and he imagines this really deep, sinister voice doing that whole, "You will write, and you will write now." To be honest, if I did that, it would scare me stupid, and I probably still wouldn't write. So his motivation might be slightly different. You know, the things that he does to make himself motivated might be wildly different from what I might use. I mean, for me, I also use a negative motivation to start writing on my bad days. And the one I use is watching myself slip into even more poverty than I'm used to right now. And that usually is enough for me to go, damn, I'd better write something right now so that people will buy from me. Let's look at that in even more detail. Now, here's the issue here. Let's think about this for a second. What we're actually saying is, like, here's this individual, and that's what they look like from the top. See, there's their nose, there's a couple of ears, they're looking that way. That's a person. We all look like that from the top. Here's this person, and what we're saying is that for them, they've still got this iceberg thing going on, and their motivation for doing stuff is all down here, and that's unique. That is their relationship with whatever it is they do, and it's context dependent. There's two things in there. There's them as an individual, and then there's the thing that they're doing. You know, their motivation for being a great golfer might be wildly different from their motivation for being a great writer, for example. So this might work differently. And what we've also said is that for a different person, that motivation may not work in the same way. It may not, in which case the question that you might be asking is, well, why bother looking at this? You know, what does it gain you? Well, what I'm actually going to suggest to you is that there is a meta level of stuff going on here. Meta level is kind of like NLP jargon to say, like, the level above, a different level of what of looking and analyzing what's going on. Now, what I'm going to suggest is that this person's relationship between what they're doing and what the sequences are working in their head is something that's really, really useful to be able to deconstruct and then look at here. If we might turn around and go back to this example of writing and me versus Stephen King. Now, Stephen King is using this kind of motivation about the big scary voice behind him that's just about to chase him if he doesn't write. And I'm using this negative motivation about sliding ever further into poverty as a way of motivating myself to start writing. Now, if you notice, in both sets of circumstances, that is negative motivation. The reason that negative motivation is really good for stuck states is that actually negative motivation works faster. It's not healthy to continue with negative motivation, but it's a great way of moving people out of stuck states. How do I know that? Well, I know that because I've modeled enough people in enough different contexts and seen exactly that kind of structure to know that that is a really useful way of being able to shift people into another gear to get them moving. I also know, I'm giving you that health warning, that it's not the most useful and most healthy state to stay in, because I've seen the structures that have happened with people that stay in that state and how that doesn't produce the tremendous results that may be moving into a positive state and looking towards a future that's far greater. And I know the same model is true for Stephen King, and I know it's also very much true for myself. There were two questions we were talking about. Why go on a practitioner course? More specifically, why go on my practitioner course? Okay, NLP practitioner courses, you can get lots from them. There's tools, there's techniques, there's lots of stuff that you can use in loads and loads of different contexts. That's why practitioner courses are great. You will find, if you look at my FAQ page, you'll find lots and lots of detail about all the structures and techniques and tools that you can get on my practitioner course. But the answer to the big question, why should you go on my practitioner course, is simply because my entire focus is on this modeling business here. And it's not just modeling what happens on the outside, but it's all about this business, what you can model on the inside. That, I think, is what NLP is about. That's what I think all practitioner courses should be about. That's what my practitioner course focuses on. So on the course, you will get some terrific models. I've spent years doing this accelerated learning thing. I know how to accelerate pretty much any kind of learning and in different kind of contexts, and how you might want to run some sequences in your head and the structures that you might want to put in place to change your beliefs to be able to learn things. Now, the great thing for me is that I've spent years as a trainer. I was a trainer a long time before I was an NLP trainer. So I know that end of stuff, and I know how you can structure and sequence all of those things so that you can work it for other people. That's whether you're a coach or a trainer or a consultant, how you structure that kind of material. To me, I have this passion around learning because I think that's the greatest skill that you could ever possibly have. If you can turn around and say, I can learn anything in the shortest, most efficient time possible, and I think you're on to a win for everything. I've got structures around all sorts of stuff. Say, for example, let me give you my story about sales. I'm not a natural salesperson. I've only spent a few years in sales, really, and that's only really been since I've been working for myself, which I suppose is probably now 15, 20 years maybe. Now, the reason that I got good at selling very, very quickly was just this, and this is part of the modeling processes. When I left full-time employment and started working for myself, I thought people would come to me because I knew that I was good as a trainer and as a coach, and I'd done all this NLP stuff. I know that I've got a proven track record in all of these areas, so people would be flocking to my door, you know, hire my services. They didn't come. They didn't come because I knew bugger all about sales and marketing. Now I have this idea that it doesn't matter how good you are at whatever you're good at, if you don't know how to sell and market yourself, you'll never get anywhere with it. Once I'd realized that was what the issue was, what I did was start really researching the sales and marketing thing. And one of the big structures around accelerated learning is can you actually articulate it, explain it, or train it with other people? And this is one of my natural processes. If I want to learn to do something, the first place I'll go is see if I can explain it to someone else. If I can explain it to them, then the next thing I want to do is see if I can integrate it into their life. You know, give them the skill. And if I can give them the skill, then I want to make a training program out of it so that I can do it on a mass scale. The more I do that, the more I get great at it myself, or greater at it, because I will do the research behind it. Hopefully with that you'll start seeing where my attitude, my beliefs around how I do these things work. All of my practitioner course is about firstly being able to give you the tools and the tips and the tricks and the techniques to be able to create these models, but it's actually also about being able to integrate certain key models into your life right from the start, because they will just help and serve you a purpose. And what I mean by that is, say for example, this business, we've got a very, very big detailed model about how you can construct the basis of personality, you know, with skills and behaviors at the top, attitudes, beliefs and identity at the bottom here, and how you can deconstruct the way that works so that you could get maximum leverage at any point along this triangle. Having that model at the forefront of your mind and embedded on an unconscious level gives you the ability to use that for any kind of modeling process that you want, but actually create structures in your own head that move you forward. So we will look at some of the big models like that. We will look at some of the smaller models, like we will dramatically increase your reading speed. I think everyone should be reading at least 1500 words a minute as a normal speed. And if you practice a little, doubling that wouldn't be a problem whatsoever. And if you were on a study program where reading was very, very important to you, we could increase that speed dramatically further than that. It is a learned art. It is something that you need to practice, and we will show you the nuts and bolts of how that sort of thing works on the course. But more importantly, we will talk about how none of those tools and techniques will ever work until you get a mindset and you get the values and the beliefs right in the first place. And we'll talk about how you can do that. So we'll give you models like that. We'll give you models for hypnotic language and how you deconstruct how people go into trance. In fact, we're going to model how people go into trance, and then we're going to be able to reconstruct that with our language so you can take anyone into trance. In fact, by the end of the course, you'll be so good at that sort of stuff, you can take your people into trance without even talking to them. Just skills that happen naturally, and we're going to model how these sorts of things happen. But the key thing, the absolute bit that's going to make the biggest difference, I think, for anyone, the key point is not learning these models, but actually learning the process of modeling. That is the key, and that's what you'd learn on my practitioner course, and that is why this practitioner course is absolutely worth going on. So just to sum up then and give you an idea of what's going on, okay, when you are modeling, and you can start doing this right now, when you are modeling a person and their skills, there's several things that you want to do. That's the physical bit. So how do they hold their racket? How do they hit balls with it? That's the physical end of modeling, and that's an important thing to look at when you're modeling a physical skill. The more important part of that is, what's the sequence of representations that go through their head? Say, like, if you're looking at one particular shot, maybe a backhand shot that they're using, for example, what's the sequence that they go through in their heads to be able to be in the right place, to be able to move in exactly the right ways to take that shot? Then behind all of that, you want to look at, you know, what's going on in their heads, what's their mindset, what's their attitude, what beliefs do they have that allows them to be there working at the kind of level that they work at. But more importantly than that, to me, is how do they deal with not being at the top and then getting to the top despite the circumstances being against them. So those are all parts of modeling, and if you know what you're looking for, this stuff pops out easily from how they move, how they talk, what they say, and that would be the roots of modeling. So that really is what modelling's about and what practitioner courses are about, and specifically what my practitioner course is about. If you want to find out some more details, there'll be links underneath this video. There's a FAQ page which has got lots more stuff. It's got the specific content of what the course is about and who it might apply to and how you can book yourself on it. So go there, have a look, see if it's something that excites you. And thanks for your time, thanks for your attention, and I shall see you later.